This week on Maker Update, a soap vomiting unicorn, two new boards from Arduino, a mini marble elevator, a NeoPixel thumb war, pool noodle box bots, Lego pinball, an Android tape deck, a business card stylophone, Hobart's entry-level MIG welder, and the Adafruit Cricket. Hey, I'm Donald Bell, and welcome to another Maker Update. Man, a lot has happened in the past 2 weeks. Go-karts were built, Maker Faire Bay Area came and went, I got a new 3D printer, and I started a new part-time job at Autodesk, which is why I'm publishing this on a Friday. But it's all good news, I'll catch you up on some of it in a minute, but first let's get started with the project of the week. Check out this soap vomiting unicorn by Britt Michelsen. This is a 3D printed enclosure for an off-the-shelf automatic soap dispenser. You load up soap through the horn, switch it on by pressing the right nostril, and a sensor on its neck triggers the soap dispenser when your hand is nearby. Britt has a great instructable up for the project, walking you through the design, 3D printing, and fitting components. She also has some great tips on finishing your 3D prints to get a smooth, professional look. It's a hilarious yet useful project. There aren't a lot of parts to print, and the electronics seem fairly straightforward to hack together. This one's going on my personal project list. It's time for some news, lots of news. First off, for those of you who couldn't make it out to the Maker Faire Bay Area this past weekend, I've got the next best thing. Down in the show notes, you'll find links to Make's own wrap-up post and their two live videos from Maker Faire, which are each around 8 hours long and filled with great talks and demos. In fact, even if you were at Maker Faire Bay Area, I know for a fact you couldn't have seen everything. The links down here are a great way to see what you missed. Also in there, I've got a link to the opening sprint race for the Power Racing Series. This year, I had two cars in the race, Kitty Grabs Back, and my newest car, Business Lunch, driven by my friend Jordan Bunker. The motors on Business Lunch burned out on the final lap, but Jordan still managed to get third place. Overall, our team raked in a bunch of medals, ruined both our cars, but had a lot of fun. The big Maker tech news out of Maker Faire was Arduino's announcement of the MKR Vidor 4000 board. This is a small FPGA-based project board due out in June, price TBD. The FPGA capability allows the code to dictate the architecture of the chip so it can be highly customized for your project. That means that every pin can be configured to either be an input or an output or an I2C or a PWM, whatever your project needs. Massimo Bonzi also announced a new generation of the Arduino Uno with built-in Wi-Fi. The new version includes an integrated gyroscope sensor so you can use the board itself as a kind of control input. Pricing is also TBD, but the board should roll out mid-June. More projects, rapid fire. Greg Zumwalt has a new instructable up for his 3D printed Marblevator mini loop. Aside from a 300 RPM gear motor, a ball bearing, a switch, and a panel mount power jack, everything you see here is 3D printed, and you can find files for all the parts in the instructable. Gary Wells made this dueling button mashing game using two arcade buttons, small NeoPixel rings, and an Adafruit trinket. It's like a digital thumb war. Two players compete to see who can mash their button faster. It looks like fun. Another alt control style project I found this week is Boxy Box by Daniel Plata, Simone Pivetta, and Samar Gmach. It's a robot boxing game where two players get in these cardboard box costumes with animated LED matrix faces and arcade buttons on the side connected to a teensy microcontroller. The boxers whack each other with pool noodles, trying to hit the other player's arcade button. The first person to three hits wins. Mikeasaurus on Instructables has a fun guide on designing and printing his and her razor holders. The guide is based on Tinkercad and is a nice inroad for learning how to add more nuanced details like chamfers and lips to your Tinkercad designs. Lego Man Productions has a guide on making a working mini pinball game completely from Legos and a couple rubber bands. Artur, Młynarz created this Tapeless tape deck by retrofitting an Android phone into a vintage deck and creating a custom Android application to give it the appearance of moving tape. You'll need to route power and audio cables from the phone internally and pop out the plastic cover from the cassette tray to use the touchscreen, but if you can find a cool working deck like this with VU meters and integrated amp, this is a cool hack. Finally, Tim Alex Jacobs made this playable MIDI stylophone business card. The card communicates MIDI note data over a built-in USB connection to Tim walks you through the prototype, the PCB design, and his trick for doubling up the thickness to create the USB plug. It's time for another cool tool review. This time we're going to take a look at the Hobart Handler 140 MIG welder. This is my welder. I got it on Amazon for around $500, and in my opinion, it is the best quality entry-level welder you can get. I'm going to show you why. And if you want to get one for yourself, you can use the Amazon link in the description, which helps support my videos and the Cool Tools blog. I just got into welding about a year and a half ago, and I'll admit I was intimidated. Luckily, I had a friend show me the basics, and he let me borrow his Lincoln electric welder to work on my first go-kart frame for Maker Faire. But after a while, I realized I really needed to invest in my own welder. The obvious choice was to go with a Lincoln, since I was always used to using one, and they're easy to get at Home Depot. But after doing some research, this $500 Hobart had a lot of reviews raving about its quality, so I gave it a shot, and I'm glad I did. Here's why I recommend this as a great beginner's MIG welder. First, it runs off standard 110 volt household power. Professional welding setups typically run off 220, and the ones that run off 110 are often a little weak. This one has plenty of power for getting nice welds on steel tubing and angle iron. The trade-off is that it can't do continuous welds for more than a few minutes before it needs to rest. If welding is your job and you're doing it all day, that's an obvious deal breaker, but for what I do as a hobbyist, I'm never spending more than a minute on any particular weld, so I never even think about this limitation. The second great benefit for beginners is that it comes set up for flux core wire right out of the box and includes a reel of flux wire. What this means as a beginner is that you can get welding straight away because the flux wire doesn't need shielding gas, which most beginners don't have on hand. After a few days, I was able to score a tank of shielding gas and some regular MIG welding wire, which delivers better results for me. When you make this switch, you have to change the polarity on the welder by unscrewing and swapping two wires, but it takes just a minute, and I think overall, most beginners will be happy that this is set up for flux core out of the box so that they can get right to practicing. The third thing that's great about this package is that the components are high enough quality that you may never need to replace them. From the gas regulator to the gun to the 10-foot grounding cable and the extra tip, there's a higher touch on every little component compared to what I've seen on other entry-level welders. My impression is that to compete with Lincoln and Home Depot and Harbor Freight, Hobart is betting on quality to differentiate what they're offering. And it works for me. It got me through an intense build with my latest go-kart. And for the record, no one from Hobart is paying me to say any of this, just to be clear. If you've been intimidated by welding, I encourage you to go take a class at your local makerspace or have a friend show you the basics. As a maker, it opens up a lot of possibility. If you want to pick up this same setup, I've got a link for you in the description along with what I use for a helmet, a welding table, wire brush, and gloves. All of them are inexpensive but useful options. And remember, you can see thousands of reader-recommended tools like these at cool-tools.org. I have some more tools and tips to share. Through Gareth Branwen's Tips of the Week column, I learned about Voronator.com. The site allows you to upload 3D files which are then processed with a Voronoi pattern and sent back to you. The results are these organic-looking filament-saving designs. For the right application, it's a neat tool to have bookmarked. For another take on working with Voronoi patterns, Dan Porter shared an instructable with me on how to apply and dial in the effect using Autodesk's free mesh mixer software. This week, I learned that Mike Warren, aka Mikeasaurus from Instructables, is offering in-person workshops and one-on-one instruction in the Bay Area through tristudio.co. As a lot of you know, Mike is one of my favorite makers. And if you're looking for a guru to help you with 3D design, woodworking, electronics, or flame-throwing skateboards, this is a cool way to rent his brain for a bit. Adafruit has introduced a new board called the Cricut. That's a sort of robot platform breakout for the Circuit Playground Express board. For $30, you get a bunch of screw terminals that break out connections for servos, motors, speakers, LEDs, and solenoids. Plus, a little I.O. breadboard and four capacitive touchpads. Speaking of Adafruit, watching Noah and Pedro on 3D Hangouts this past week, I learned that there is a GitHub page full of Fusion 360 files for a bunch of Adafruit boards and components. So if you ever wanted to design an enclosure that perfectly fits a board or a button that they sell, you can probably pop a 3D model of it right into your design. Adafruit has also announced version 3.0 beta, of CircuitPython. This is the software that allows a growing number of their boards to be programmed using Python code instead of Arduino. There's a lot of little changes and improvements, but it is beta, so there's likely some kinks to be worked out. Maker fairs this weekend. We have Berlin, Germany, Strasbourg, France, Vilnius, Lithuania, Saskatoon, Saskatchewan, Ljubljana, Slovenia, Gibson's, British Columbia, and Kharkiv, Ukraine. I think it's one of the few weekends where there's not a fair happening in the US, but if you're out near one, go check it out. All right, and that does it for this week's Maker Update. Be sure to subscribe, leave a comment, leave a thumbs up, get a Hobart for a great hobbyist welding rig, and no show next week, but I will send out an email, so get on that email list if you're not there already. And the plan going forward is to publish these every other Friday. I know I was your Wednesday guy, but now I'll have to be your Friday guy. Autodesk has me coming in the office on Tuesdays and Wednesdays, so that's kind of throwing everything up in the air. But I appreciate your flexibility. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon.